Today, inshallah ta'ala, we start Bab al-Sidq. Bab al-Sidq is very important. Of course, all those chapters are from Sunnah, they are all important. This is hard. Certain parts we know it is right, but to apply it in our life, at times, we feel that it is hard because the truth and being truthful is so hard. At times, especially when you think that if you lie a little bit, maybe you'll get a benefit. And that's why Rasulullah sallam has warned us specifically against this. تحرّوا الصدق ولو رأيتم الهلكة فيه واجتنبوا الكذب ولو رأيتم النجاة فيه. ففي الأول تحرّوا الصدق ولو رأيتم الهلكة فيه فإن النجاة فيه. Seek the truth. Even if you think destruction is in it, because indeed Savior is in it. Look at which is very interesting. And avoid lies. Even if you think Savior is in it, because indeed destruction is in it. And this from Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, because always, you see, here is the point. Every good thing is from Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala, right? All goodness from Allah. And always we ask Allah Subhanahu Wa Ta'ala to seek the goodness of Allah from Allah. Right? We ask Allah from Fadli. So we should never ask Allah bi ma'asiyat Allah. We should not seek the Fadl of Allah through the ma'asiyah of Allah. We cannot disobey Allah to get His Fadl, to get his goodness. This is no-brainer. I mean, normally the case. But the problem is we never remember this when we go through our life. We always think that by lying, we will achieve a benefit. In fact, it's only by the truth that we'll achieve a benefit. This is why I really, again, we said this story a few months ago, very recently, we talked about وَالثَّلَاثَ الَّذِينَ خُلِّفُوا. Those three were left to the order of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when Rasulullah sallam came from Tabuk, and they did not go with them. And when Rasulullah sallam came back, they were left for the judgment by Allah. And they stayed for 50 days until the order came from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He has forgiven them. And what did save them? And everybody used to tell them, okay, well, I think we should say the story to remind you, just quickly, we're not going to go in details. Just quickly, not to bore you. I think you know the story all, and you know it very well. It says, Ka'b ibn Malik, he mentioned the story. And Ka'b ibn Malik, he said that Rasulullah Sallam ordered us to go for Tabuk at time when the harvest was about to come. There is need, and there was and at that time I was also, I had prepared and I had my mounts. I had bought some camels or some horses at that time. So he said, I have all the rukuba, the mounts that I need in order to travel with him. And he also, part of the things he said also, that he never stayed behind in any battle for Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam or any trip that Rasulullah took, except Badr. And in Badr, they were allowed to. It was by choice. So they have asked them by choice. And when Tabuk came, Rasulullah again, in all his other battles, would actually tell the people of different direction, so that if news come out to the enemies, then they don't know, and he will wait till the end and so on. See, except for Tabuk, because they were taking very harsh roads, very difficult journey, at a very hot days, people would have to prepare for it, they would have to have all their provisions in order to be able to survive. So he told them in advance. So everything was known. I say, everyone, he knows, they went out, they prepared, and they got ready for the day that Rasulullah told them. He procrastinated. He says, every day tomorrow, he goes and doesn't buy anything and comes back. Even though he says things were there. And at the time, I was able more than any other time. So there is no excuse. He's removing any excuse for himself, for the story actually, so in advance. And then they got ready, Rasulullah told them to leave, and they left. He said, no problem, I can always catch up with them. A couple of days I catch up with them. So he goes out to buy, he does not buy, he goes back. Same story again. 2-3 days he says, I can do it. And then he said, until they went far away. he recognized now so many days of travel, so he knew that they became quite far. Then he said, I was about to leave and to follow them, and I wish I did. But I said, they're too far, so what am I going to do now? So I'm going to wait. You know, this is what happens to you, no? It happens to all of us sometimes. We have something to do and we keep, you know, postponing it, and then at the end we find excuses not to do it at all. And that's exactly what... unfortunately, that was a very serious issue. So when it happened to him, he was very disturbed. And he was told later on that Rasulullah, when he arrived to Tabuk, he asked about him. He did not mention him at all until he gets there. He said, what happened to Ka'b ibn Malik? So one of the Sahabis, he said, oh, Ka'b ibn Malik, ya Rasulullah, he got busy with his with his covers, with his like shelters that is there in the worms, and looking at his shoulders, meaning, you know, he likes himself, like he, so sitting in there having fun, staying with his wife. Young man is having fun and you know, looking at his shoulders, like this part of like. So Mu'adh ibn Jabal said almost to the effect that this is not true, this is not proper, stop it. To something to that effect, like to stop him from. And he said, Ya Rasulallah, wallahi, we know nothing about Ka'b ibn Malik, but all everything good. He says, Mu'adh ibn Jabal, that Rasulullah did not answer. Did not say yes, did not say no, did not say anything. But he was hoping that he would come, would actually come. There was the story is very long and there is many other stories, but I'm just trying to quickly remind you. Then, when Ka'b ibn Malik realized, or they received the news in Medina that Rasulullah is in his way coming. So now he's about to arrive. So he said, now I start focusing all my thoughts, all my energy, mental energy, to prepare myself to find out what kind of a lie I will tell Rasulullah so that he would forgive me from the mistake I did. What kind of excuse? He does not say, you know, in the sense of a lie, but it is an excuse, but not real. It's just an excuse why I did not, why I was not able to go with everyone else. He says, and I keep figuring it out. I keep trying to make up the story. But as when Rasulullah ﷺ came, I just couldn't. I left everything and I went to him. He says, most of the munafiqeen, they come there, they say a story, and Rasulullah ﷺ would make dua for them and tell them, go. You know, may Allah forgive you and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept and you go. They say, Rasulullah, this and this is other. He also felt so bad while he was waiting, because he said, I wake up in Medina now that I stayed. I wake up in Medina every day. I find only the streets of Medina, only either munafiqeen or people who are kids, or people who have who had reason for staying behind as udhr. They had an excuse, a reason, a good reason, like sick or old people or something. And he found himself the only strong, able youth who was walking around in Medina alone, and he felt really very bad. That was like a torture for him. That was like partly when he realized he made a very bad mistake. So when Rasulullah ﷺ came and he heard the munafiqeen, so many of them went one after the other, and they all say, Rasulullah, forgive us, we could not do it for this and that, and all some of those any kind of statements. Rasulullah ﷺ would take it on the appearance. By the way, we have to talk later on. Remember the story, because we have to talk about what do we learn about some of these issues. So as we analyze the story and the hadith, that we will go through it, inshallah ta'ala. So he went in and he said, but by the time I got in front of Rasulullah sallallahu, I told him the truth. I said, Ya Rasulullah, by Allah, I have never was more able than that, capable of preparing myself, having the mounts, having the provisions, having what I need. And remember also, when we say that there are some people came to him to carry them and he didn't have, and they went back crying, that they were crying not to have.
That was in Ghazwat Tabuk, specifically the ayah?
No, the ayah was in part of the Ghazwat Tabuk, in part of the preparation of Ghazwat Tabuk, yes. And there was some other Ghazwat also, same thing happened. But this specific story of Ka'b ibn Malik was because of Tabuk. Like, you see the keenness of the Sahaba, their hirs, their sincere intention to go out with the Rasulullah, that when they are unable, they would actually cry. So imagine he had. So when he says that, this is really like he's condemning himself, like totally admitting full guilt of the situation, that I had everything I need. I had the time, I had the money, I had the mounts, I could have bought the provisions, but I kept procrastinating until time passed and until you came back. And I don't know why, at times when he says the story, it was qada wa qadar, but he felt like he was unable to go on with it, something was holding him. But of course, this is all from ourselves. So, Rasulullah ﷺ told him, you go, you don't talk with anybody until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings something for you. So it was, everybody was giving an excuse, so he forgave them and finished. But for him, he admitted there was a serious guilt here, and Rasulullah ﷺ said that could not be left because that was an obligation. And therefore, there has to be some consequences to somebody dropping the call to go and in defense of Islam and to go with Rasulullah ﷺ. That becomes very serious. So I leave your situation on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you wait until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bring his hukm, bring his judgment in your situation. So go until we see. And you don't talk to anyone, you don't speak with any person until something comes down on you. So he left. So many of the Sahaba came to him, and some asked him, why didn't you say like the other people have said, the Rasulullah would ask forgiveness and then you'll be forgiven anyway, we'll make dua for you, then you'll be forgiven anyway. And so many came around him, and he said, I was almost tempted to go back and change my story, but then I realized, no, I will stick with the truth, it doesn't matter how much it cost me. And he refused to behave similar to the hypocrites, to the munafiqeen. So he said, no, I'll stick with the truth. So he moved on, he went to his house for 40 days, people would not talk to him. He said, it took us 50 days altogether, but after 40, and people would not talk to him. And at one time he went into his cousin Talha ibn Abdullah. We talked about Talha last time in one hadith, and this time he went to him. He would not open the door for him. He went over the fence. He climbed the fence and came down, and he made salam. He did not answer him. He asks him by the name of Allah, don't you know that I love Allah and I love Rasulullah? He would not answer him. He repeats it. And then finally he told him, I don't know. Allah and Rasulullah knows. So he said, I don't know. I mean, that's it. If Allah told us that, if Rasulullah told, that's it. So he started crying. And he felt very bad about himself, that he reached this degree that people actually became, not even those that were so most beloved to him, his relative, his neighbor, his everybody, taking such a very serious position. This really like earth narrowed. He says, I went to the masjid, I pray, I see Rasulullah there, I try to look at him, I say assalamu alaikum, and I look at him to see if he's going to answer the salam, or that his lips is going to move. He would not answer the salam, and I look to see if his lips is moving or not. And every time I go in the salah, he looks at me, I realize he looks at me. So the minute I look at him, he turns back, he turns away. So Rasulullah also feels the sympathy, and he feels the emotion toward him, but he can't, this is the order of Allah. So he wait, they all waiting for the order of Allah. 40 days like this. Then in the 40th day, he receives the messenger of Allah, receives a messenger from Rasulullah ﷺ to tell him that Rasulullah ﷺ has ordered you to isolate yourself from your wife. Meaning no relationship, no marriage relationship, even that further punishment. So he said, you mean I should divorce her? He said, no, he did not say you divorce her. He said, no relationship. So he told her, go to your family until we see what will happen with this. So he was not asked to let her leave the house, but he told her, you go there and you wait for me. And he says, Hilal ibn Umayyah, I believe it's Hilal ibn Umayyah, he asked when he left first time from Rasulullah, is was there anybody else with me that that happened to them the same like what happened to me? They told him yes, and this is when he was about to come back to change the story. He asked, was there anyone else in the same situation like me? They said yes, Hilal ibn Umayyah and Marar ibn Rabi' al-Amri, two other people with him. He said, alhamdulillah, I wait until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would give his order on all of us. Hilal ibn Umayyah was an older man. Ka'b, Ubay ibn Ka'b, he was, or Ka'b ibn Malik, sorry, Ka'b ibn Malik was a young man. But Hilal ibn Umayyah was an older man. So when Hilal ibn Umayyah, this happened, his wife went to Rasulullah s.a.w. said, Ya Rasulullah, Hilal ibn Umayyah cannot help himself by himself, and you ask it to isolate himself, so I should leave him. I can't leave him. If I leave him, he will be lost. So he said, no problem that you stay, but don't let him touch you. She said, Ya Rasulullah, he is so big, he has no movement in him. He can't move. That's of course a metaphor for the fact that he is not, will not be able to do the what Rasulullah said not to do. He's even unable. So he said, in this case, you can help him, there is no problem. So some of the Sahaba that they know him, they said to Ka'b ibn Malik, Ya Ka'b, you don't need to send your wife away. Ask Rasulullah for permission. Hilal asked it, and his wife asked it, and she got the permission to stay with him. Ask your wife so that your wife, ask Rasulullah so that your wife would help you, would serve you through this this time, not to stay alone and not to... So he said, by Allah, I'm not going, you know, Hilal is older than me. I am a young man, strong. And if I go to ask Rasulullah and says no, why would I do this now? It's enough for me. I'm not going to go into engaging anything else. I will wait until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala answers this. In the 50th day, before even the 50th day, with the difficulty there, this was even before the 40 days finished, just at the end of them, he gets a booty from the north, from Heracle, has sent somebody from, at that time, of course, the Romans were looking at Islam as a big threat, and that they were fighting, so they were looking to find some spies and some people to work from within the state. And when they heard about the story, it seems to have gone all over the places, so they loved to see, because normally, this is like a, for Rasulullah and his companion, it was like a fort with a strong leader inside, that he's dealt with everybody in such a way that he brought this mahabba, love and affection and connection, that the people could not get to him and could not get through stranger, except to those hypocrites, and the hypocrites were known, so they were not able to get somebody to be close and be able to pass some messages to them. So when the Roman found out about Ka'b ibn Malik's story, they sent a messenger. So he says, I was one day walking in the market, just walking, nobody's looking at me, nobody's talking to me, but then a man came to tell me that this man is asking for you, who's saying, where is Ka'b ibn Malik? So here he is. So he said, the people told him about him. So he came and he gave me a letter written from Iraq. And that he took it and he went home to read, and he found out that he said, we know what your friend has done to you. Come to us and we'll take care of you. Look, you see, you don't leave. You know, you have to be aware of that. That if this happens at the time of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, imagine today. I mean, what happens today? This is really serious. History keeps repeating itself, and those stories, they come, but in a bigger ways also, with more corruption and more problems within the world settings in general. You'll find more of this, of course, taking place. Sometimes it was with justification. Sometimes we will justify different things and so on. So he said, oh, subhanAllah, another fitna, big fitna. So he said, so I put it in, you know, tanur or kanun, which is, you know, where you burn fire at home, either for warmth or for cooking and for different things. So we put it in there, like part of with the wood that they use, the tree branches that they use to burn. So just put it with it in there. And he said, Allah, help me with this difficulty. So got the news, he has to leave his wife, and then he waited in isolation, and then for 10 days. In the 50th day, as he was after Salatul Fajr sitting on the roof of his house, he heard that there was a Salatul Fajr with Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, and right after Fajr he told the Sahaba that he has received Quran. So people start to tell us, two people went to Hilal ibn Umayyah and Marara ibn Rabi' al-Amri. So the one went to Marara, and few went to Hilal ibn Umayyah, and two people came specifically to Ka'b ibn Malik. In fact, in another narration and different stories, that they say one of them was Abu Bakr Siddiq radiallahu anhu, the one that was in the horse that he wanted so much to let him know. He said two. One did not have a mount, did not have something to carry him on to get, and the other one had a horse. So the one that didn't have the mount, he went in the top of the mountain and he called on him, Ya Ka'b ibn Malik. So I heard him. The minute I heard his voice, I realized that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent my forgiveness, so I went in prostrating to Allah at that moment. And the man came with the horse, told him, he raised his voice, said that Allah has sent the Quran on you. So the one on the horse came and told him, so he waited for the one that he heard his voice first, and he was wearing two clothes on him, he took them. He said, by Allah, he did not have any other clothes but those. So I gave it to him, and as a gift by giving him those good news. And he went in to borrow from his neighbor two other pieces of cloth to put them on to go to see Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, because they asked him to come to Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So he came. In the way, of course, as he went there to Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, Rasulullah told him about the Quran, and there was a bit of discussion happened between him and Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. It was not Iraqli necessarily. He says Kitaban min Malik Ghassan. He was a king, one of those kings of the different things that belong to the Romans, but not necessarily from them. Is Nabti. This is Nabti from Sham, from the north at the time was still occupied, and there were different little kingdoms here and there. So it was the king of Ghassan. So just to correct part of this.
Ghassan is in Syria?
Yeah, in Sham, yeah. He says that the sound was faster than the horse. So he took off his two pieces of cloth and he said that the people, انطلقت أم رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, so I went in aiming to see رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. So the people would actually face him as he was coming in, congratulating him, يهنؤه على التوبة, so congratulating him for repentance and for the acceptance of his توبة to الله سبحانه وتعالى. And he said when he went to the masjid, nobody from Muhajirin stood up. He wanted to add all those things. He always remember. He says that except Talha ibn Abdullah, when he saw him coming, he got up and he went in and asked him to come to sit in his place.
Talha ibn Malik is from the Muhajirin?
Yeah, no, Ka'b ibn Malik from Ansar.
Okay, and didn't you just say
that Talha
was his cousin?
Talha was a relative, yeah. So he came. Have some phone or something. And he said that everybody was giving him the good news. He says, "Wallahi ma qama ilayya rajul min muhajirin ghayra." Qala fa kana Ka'b la insa. So it must be. He says. فلما سلمت على رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم, now we give the salam now after all the repentance, قال وهو يبرق وجهه من السرور. So the face of رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم was illuminating with the happiness that they've been forgiven. He was waiting for that too. He was in pain to رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم to see them in this situation, and he was waiting for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give the order. He says, فلما ضاقت عليهم الأرض بما رحبت. This was the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describing that earth narrowed. It doesn't matter how wide it was. For them, those three, they didn't know where to go. No faces, nobody can carry. Now, alhamdulillah, the reception is fantastic. They are laughing, they are smiling in his face. And so he says, إذا سر استنار وجهك. And Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, when he's happy, his face illuminates with نور. استنار وجهه حتى كأنه قطعة قمر. Until as he looks like a moon, a part of the moon. حتى يعرف ذلك من everybody would recognize that. Like when he's happy, everybody would know it. قلت يا رسول الله إن من توبتي أن أنخلع من مالي أو أتخلع من مالي صدقة إلى الله. So he says, part of my tawbah is to take part of my money to give it صدقة الله سبحانه وتعالى to رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. قال أمسك عليك بعض مالك. To hold some of your wealth with you, like don't leave it all, don't get carried away, don't exaggerate in the sadaqah, keep some of your money. So he said, I will hold my wealth in Khaybar. So he still gave sadaqah, but he held part of it. And then he said, this is the reason I'm putting this at the head of this chapter, really, this story, because he said something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala certainly mentioned it in the ayah as well, to pinpoint this to all of us. He said, وَإِنَّ مِنْ تَوْبَتِي, it's part of my tawbah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that he's been like talking to Allah at all this time. He's been, Ya Allah, I will, if you accept my tawbah, I will never lie again. Ya Allah, if you accept my tawbah, I'll pay this sadaqah. So son told him, he reduced some of this birth. And then he also said, Alaykum as-salam. Alaykum as-salam. And he said that part of my tawbah, you guys have enough seats around you?
Yeah.
He said that part of my tawbah is that I would never make any talk except the truth. I would never say anything but the truth. This part of his tawbah. ما بقيت all my life, as long as I'm alive. قال فوالله, he said, by Allah, ما أعلم أحدا من المسلمين, I don't know anybody among Muslims, أبلاه الله من الصدق في الحديث منذ ذكرت ذلك رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أحسن مما أبلاني. I don't know any Muslims that Allah سبحانه وتعالى has given him this صدق في حديث, to be truthful when he talks, as much as he gave me. In, like, he's very proud of the fact that he really stayed with it. And also did not forget to say, he says, والله ما تعمدت كذبا منذ قلت ذلك رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أبدا. I did not intend to lie, to make a lie, to say any lie since I promised رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم this ever. So until this day, the day he was saying, narrating this story, and I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that I will die on it, meaning to stay like this. So again, he's making sure to continue his life to this way. And this is why the ayah, when it came down, the ayah was very straightforward, subhanallah. وَعَلَى الثَّلَاثَةِ الَّذِينَ خُلِّفُوا. And the three that they were, خُلِّفُوا mean left behind. Left behind, he actually explains in another narration that the word خُلِّفُوا is not because they were left behind, did not go to Tabuk. He said, they were left behind from the forgiveness, from that Rasulullah forgave everybody, but left the three behind, did not do anything. So he says that word khulifu is not because they did not go, no, it is because they were, the judgment for them was postponed, was binding or bending the response from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to their actions. That's why it continues to say, and actually it makes a lot of sense now in the meaning, حتى إذا ضاقت عليهم الأرض بما رحبت, until earth has narrowed in them, regardless of its wideness, it has narrowed in them, بما رحبت, even with its wideness, even with its expand, it has narrowed on them, and it has become so hard on them. وضاقت عليهم أنفسهم, and even their souls become narrow on them, like, and even they can't even stand themselves, like they like within themselves. Imagine the pain you can feel that problem. وظنوا, and they thought, أن لا ملجأ من الله إلا إليه. سبحان الله. Until they found out that the only way to Allah the only way from Allah is to Allah. You understand? The only way to get out of the punishment of Allah is through Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No other asbab. Do you remember I always used to say this about Aisha, Hajar alayhi salam, that when she went from Safa to Marwa looking for water, and though she was promised, and she was actually hoping for a caravan, right, to bring the water. And she goes to Safa, she cannot find, so she hurries up, she goes down to go to Marwa, she hurries up in the middle, when she hears Ismail crying, she goes up into the Marwa and looks, she can't find, she comes back and she goes to Safa, and she repeats. While she was repeating this, she started to give up. Look, this is quite interesting. I'm telling you this because really, our action should be the same right from the beginning. Like, we should always remember those stories. They are there to teach us that even though she knows that Allah is going to help, but of course she expected, because we live in the life of asbab, is going to be through asbab, and the only asbab in her mind would be through a caravan coming in, bringing the water. She start to give up as the time passes, and the hope and the difficulty for her son is harder, and I'm sure for herself too, though she did not mention. Slowly she was losing hope that any man will be able to come to help her, but it's only from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In the seventh turn, when she 100% lost hope in all people but only on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, she turned around and found the water under the feet of or the heels of Ismail, right? That's exactly the same situation here. When they really, he said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is describing them now, not Ka'b ibn Malik making it, but Allah is saying, وَظَنُّوا أَلَّا مَلْجَأَ مِنُ اللَّهِ إِلَّا إِلَيْهِ. And when they ظَنُّوا, they suspected that there is no way away from Allah except to Allah, away from the punishment of Allah except coming to Allah, through coming illa ilay. I mean, come to Allah, you will get the mercy of Allah. So that's it. There is nothing else. No man, no excuses, no lies, no nothing. Khalas, that's it. You just have to stick to it and come closer to Allah. And that's when the talked to Allah and they asked Allah and they made nadr of sadaqah and of never to repeat this again and never to lie again and never to. He didn't lie, but they wanted to. They took this upon themselves that this was their label really. What made them to survive is they were all the three of them honest. They just said the truth. And what did the truth do? They are mentioned in the Holy Quran. And when they are mentioned in the Holy Quran to be forgiven, it means those are people who are they will be dwelling in Jannah, inshallah. As he said in the beginning of the hadith, though I did not attend Badr, but I attended the Mubayat al-Hudaybiyah, and it would have been better for me Hudaybiyah than Badr, he says. But Badr is more famous at the people would not born. But in fact, about Mubayat al-Hudaybiyah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned it, and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that those 1400 people that were with me in Hudaybiyah, those, we did not say the exact number, but that's the number that many of the scholars say, but he said that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that those who were with me in Hudaybiyah that put their hands in my hand, and yadullahi fawqa aydihim, and the hands of Allah was over their hands, meaning this was like Mubayat with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that all of them are dwellers of Jannah. And that's why he says, I would never, like, it's better for me Hudaybiyah than anything else, just to let us know. But since then, he is a man that has connected himself with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and here he's got a second time, his name now is mentioned in the Quran, الثلاثة وعلى الثلاثة. So those are the three, not necessarily by name, but in relation to them, of course. ثم تاب عليهم ثم تاب الله سبحانه وتعالى عليهم ليتوبوا. They could not repent until Allah سبحانه وتعالى forgive them. So Allah forgive them. First, and we always said about this, that this is part of the tawbah, to remember that when Allah سبحانه وتعالى says ثم تاب عليهم ليتوبوا, that was the sign when in the answer, I don't know if it was Al-Hasan al-Basri or who, رحمه الله, that when he told somebody that if somebody asks Allah for tawbah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would certainly forgive him. So somebody said, and how, what is your dalil on that? So he said this ayah, thumma taba Allah alayhim liyatubu, that indeed when somebody asks for tawbah, it's because Allah has forgiven him actually before he asked for the tawbah. And that's because his intention was there, his niyyah was there. And because his niyyah was there even before saying, Allah, forgive me, it's already forgiveness with this, much faster than him saying it. that in fact it is by the tawbah of Allah, that when Allah forgives, when you love Allah and Allah loves you, when you have this connection, then you'll find right away that this is the kind of relationship, that the tawbah will be there, then you will always be, will know who to call and who to look for and who to ask for tawbah and for repentance. So I always try to remind you again and again of this thing, that because it gives us a lot of hope, that when we ask Allah for forgiveness for something, it right away gives us hope that indeed He forgave us, especially when we are sincere and we carry the conditions of the tawbah, the three or four, based on whether or not it is, has a right of other people. Which is to stop knowing, to regret what you did, to stop doing the wrong, and to make intention not to do it again. It's very simple. Stop, regret, and intention not to do.
And promise never to come back.
Huh? Not to come back again to the same wrong. So stop, intend, regret, and intend. So very simple. And of course, if it has a right of other people, it was their money or something else, then pay what you owe, or make intention that the minute Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would give you, you go back and you pay that which you owe, if you took some people's right, or ask them for forgiveness, or depending on the situation and how it is. And he said, the ayah that came right after was the title of the ayah in Bab al-Sidq. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله. Oh, you who believe, and this is important. And when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says يا الذين آمنوا, it means He's calling the believer, and He tells us actually not to say آمنا وقولوا أسلمنا. He tells, but He's calling the believer, meaning anybody that follows this way is concluded among the believers, is one of the believers. So He says يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وكونوا مع الصادقين, and be with the truthful ones. So be with the truthful ones, what does it mean? It has two meanings, simply. Be with the truthful ones, may always have the company of people who are truthful. Stay with the truthful ones, stay away from liars, stay away from hypocrites, stay away from the wrong direction. So always try your best to be with those who are truthful. Also, a very important meaning, be counted among the truthful. Like, be truthful by yourself, and therefore you will be counted with the truthful. Because if you are not, you will not be with the truthful. You can't be with the truthful. If you are a liar who wanted to be with the truthful, it doesn't work, right? It's because the truthful will you'll be rejected one way, directly or indirectly, from among the people. So you think you smart, and you can pass a fast one, and you can try to convince them, and you can sell. Fish oil, or what you call the snake oil for cure all kind of things, it doesn't work. You have to think that even if the viewers still respect you and they still talk in a nice way, still they know those kind of tricks and they know all those things. So once, sooner or later, they will abandon you. So you have to be truthful in order to always have that. SubhanAllah, there is a hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He says, كونوا من أبناء الآخرة ولا تكونوا من أبناء الدنيا فإن كل أم يتبعه ولده. So be with the children of the hereafter, don't be the children of dunya, because every mother, the kids follow their mothers in general. But that's very much works with the truth. If you are truthful, you will find out always the truthful with you, and you always follow the leader that is truthful, or whatever it is truthful. So it's very much the same, like that example always remind me with the duck and the little baby ducks walking behind her, the mother. You know, and this is the fitrah, this is the nature, and that's what Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is saying very much in this hadith. Be the children of the hereafter, be the children of the truth, be the children of haqq, be the children of justice. If you always remind yourself with this way, you will always follow that way. You will always follow this road, because it will be a rule of thumb for your nature, fitrah, for you, that you will follow that which is right. So, Bab al-Sidq.